Looks like it's about time to install the MVT Digital Direct Ignition on my 86cc Minarelli project. Before I go any further, I want to say a big thank you to scootertuning.ca. They hooked me up with a discount on the MVT Ignition as well as some other parts, and they're a great company to deal with, so be sure to check them out. Now, you will notice that my engine is sitting up here on the workbench. Most of you will not need to take your engine out of the scooter in order to do this ignition installation. I'm doing it largely because I want to make sure that I can get good shots for the video of everything that I'm doing. So for me, it's easier just to have it up here on the workbench. Unless you've got a really tight frame or maybe some other complications, most of you won't have to take your engine out in order to do this. The first thing I'm doing is removing the CVT cover, and that will allow me to grab the variator later, because I'm going to need a way to turn the engine over when I'm working on the ignition, and I don't want to have to grab the rotor that I'm putting on or try to get a hold of the crank. So this will allow me to get a hold of the variator and easily turn the engine over. Next, I need to gain access to the stock ignition system. So for me, this means removing the water pump as well as my stator cover. If you have an air-cooled engine, then you'll have fan shrouds and a cooling fan that's on top of your flywheel. So I'm going to start with my stator cover. Now I need to remove my water pump cover. For me, it'll just be two bolts. If you're using a genuine Yamaha, Aprilia, some of the others, you'll actually have a third bolt here. And make sure you keep track of all of your fasteners as you remove them, because you'll need to know where they go later. Once the bolts are out, then just a little bit of outward force should pop the water pump free from the flywheel. Obviously, if you're working like I am with the engine out, you can just remove this and set it aside. But if you're working on this in the scooter and you haven't disconnected everything from your cooling system, then usually you can use a bungee cord or some zip ties and just kind of secure this somewhere out of your way. If you'll be reusing your water pump drive studs and grommets, then you want to remove those now. You can either pry the grommets off and then remove the studs, or remove them as all one piece. I actually prefer to take the grommets off first and then remove the studs. The grommets basically just have to be worked over the ends of the studs. I kind of use my wrench to start prying them sometimes. Then a 10 millimeter socket or wrench you'll need to hold the flywheel. You could have to use a flywheel holding tool or piston stop. A lot of times you can just grab the flywheel and hold it, and that'll be enough to get these off. Now the nut that holds the flywheel needs to be removed, so you can either use something to hold the engine in place, like for example this flywheel holder, or I do it simple way with an impact. And then remove the washer as well. Now we've got to get the flywheel out of the way, so you're going to need a flywheel puller for that. Most of these Minarelli engines are M27x1.0 left-hand thread, so you'll need that style of puller. This is the one I have. I wish I could tell you where to get it, because I got this years ago at a place called Dr. ATV, and I haven't seen them since, but this one makes it really easy. You don't have to work with a bunch of wrenches. So I just screw that in. Remember, it's left-hand thread, so it's going to go in the opposite way of what you're used to screwing something in. Get that fairly snug, and then with this model, normally you've got to use a couple wrenches. With this one, usually I can give it a couple of taps, and then I can pull my flywheel off. Now, in this case, when my flywheel came off, the Woodruff key was stuck to the inside of my flywheel, which is kind of ideal for me right now, because I didn't want the Woodruff key anyway. If that doesn't happen, then what you need to do is rotate the engine over till you can see the Woodruff key. I've stuck my wood rough key back into place just to show you what you'll typically find in there. And you can actually wait on this step, but I didn't want to forget about it since mine fell out. So normally you'll see your wood rough key is kind of seated in the crank. Sometimes just a little light pressure like mine, because it's not a real snug fit for whatever reason in this TPR crank, and they'll come loose. If not, you may have to just kind of make sure you've got a screwdriver aligned with that and kind of tap downward on it to get it to start coming out. And then you should be able to basically, not really pry, but move it out of the keyway in there. Set this aside somewhere, make sure you hold on to it. You won't need it for the MVT ignition, but you'll definitely need a wood rough key again if you set up another stock ignition system. If you aren't working with the engine out of the scooter as I am, then you'll need to disconnect your stator before you continue. I'll have different connectors than you have because I've replaced mine with weather pack connections, but pretty much all you have to do is look at this wire that comes up out of your stator, and you'll be able to trace that and just follow it to the ends and disconnect those. Now you should see that you've got two bolts that hold the stator plate in, so remove both of those. Make sure you keep these handy because you will need them to reinstall the MVT ignition. Next, I'll begin to remove the stator and its plate from the engine. In my case, I've been around some salt water and this was a pretty tight fit, so it's actually kind of almost corroded in there around the edges. So I'm just going to get behind there where it's not going to hurt any of the electronics and try to pry that off a little bit. There we go. Start to get that out. Yours will probably not be this difficult. Most of mine are not, but I've had a couple of occasions where I got into salt water and it's really not good. Okay, so that's loose. Before the stator can come all the way out, you'll usually have a grommet up here that fits into a hole in the case, and you kind of need to push that in and work it through the case, and then you can pull the wires through and finish removing the stator from the engine. For me, I've got nothing else back here. If you do have a premix system, you should be able to leave all that alone. Just make sure the gasket that sits over all that is in good shape, and you should be fine. I am going to go through this real quick and just clean up some of the corrosion. I just figure I might as well do it while I'm in here. I'm also going to make sure my crankshaft is clean. Just going to use a little bit of brake parts cleaner. And I'm using a plastic bristle brush. Just want to be certain that the taper area is in good condition, nice and clean, because that's what actually holds your flywheel or rotor in place. Now we're ready to begin installing the MVT ignition, beginning with the stator plate. So locate the stator plate, and then that's going to go on your engine just like the old stator did. You'll have a cutout here. That's going to aim toward the cutout in your case where the wires go through. Otherwise, you've just got to align the bolt holes. Now use the bolts that were in the stator plate of your stock ignition to install the MVT stator plate. And you may want to use some medium strength thread locker on these bolts. I'm not going to do it because I'll be doing some other changes later that you'll see, but it's a good idea if you're not going to be fiddling around with the stator plate or any of the other mounts. You may want to refer to a service manual to get the proper torque specs for these fasteners. In my case, I've just snugged them down. Now find your stator and flip it over to take a look at the back. You should find that you've got wires coming out back here, and you need to take note of that because those wires need to correspond with this cutout when the stator is installed. Take the end of the wire coming from the stator that has all the connectors on it and route it up from the inside to the outside through this hole in the engine cases. Continue to pull those through until you can get your stator roughly into position. Again, make sure that wire coming out of the back is lined up with the cutout in the stator plate. Find the bolts and washers that should have came with your kit. Slide the washers over the bolts If you're not going to do any further modifications once this is installed, then you can use a little bit of thread locker, medium strength. Otherwise, install these bolts through these slotted holes, and they correspond to these threaded holes in the stator plate. I'm just going to get these tightened down, but leave it a little bit loose. Because I want to be able to rotate this. Okay. Since these are slotted mounting holes, you can actually rotate the stator quite a bit. But I think what's best is to try to start out with a stator so the bolts are roughly in the center of each of those slotted holes. Once you're happy with that, go ahead and snug it down the rest of the way. Next up is the part of the ignition installation that makes some people a bit apprehensive about trying to install this themselves. And I'm talking about the rotor, the actual thing that replaces the flywheel. And the reason is it has to be timed to manufacturer specifications. It can't just be slid onto the crankshaft just like the stock flywheel could. But it's not that difficult. You just need to pay attention as you go and make sure you're paying attention to all the details. We're going to start with something really simple. Remove the spark plug. This part is optional, but because oil and combustion remnants tend to build up in this area, I'm just going to take a rag, actually paper towel in this case, and quickly go over the area to make sure it's a little bit cleaner. Whatever you do, just make sure that you're not getting any kind of debris that could harm your engine into the spark plug hole. Now we're going to need a bit of a specialty tool that threads into the spark plug hole. The reason is MVT, as well as most other aftermarket ignition manufacturers, specify how their ignition should be set up based on a distance in millimeters before top dead center. So for that reason, we need some way to measure the distance that the piston is away from top dead center. What I've got here is a dial indicator holder. So I made this adapter that screws in where the spark plug would normally thread in, and it holds a dial indicator, and that allows the plunger to interact with the piston, and then I can see how far the piston is from top dead center once it's set up. You can also buy these. Scootertuning.ca carries them. A lot of people carry these. If you're buying for the Minarelli engine like this, it's usually an M14 by 1.25 thread. And then you'll need a dial indicator if the kit doesn't include one. In this case, I've got a digital dial indicator. You can also use analog dial indicators if you're more comfortable with those or if that's what you've got around. But it's easiest if whatever you use has metric graduations, just because that's the specs that the manufacturers tend to give you. The other type of tool, which unfortunately I don't have one around here to show you, is a type of micrometer specially designed for this purpose that threads into the spark plug hole and allows you to measure the position of the piston. Again, you can get those from scooter parts sites as well. Personally, I find the dial indicator setup to be the most straightforward, but everyone has their own preferences. I've actually separated these to do the installation because I don't like to put any kind of force onto my dial indicator because it is a precision instrument. So the first thing I do is to thread my adapter into the spark plug hole. And I want to make sure that's snug, but I'm not really trying to put a whole lot of force on it. As long as it can't easily change position, it's fine. Then I can go ahead and slide my dial indicator down into my adapter. And then in this case, I just got a little screw here, and I put gentle pressure on it just enough to make sure that the indicator can't move around. Now with my indicator installed, I'll be able to tell when the piston is getting near the top of the bore, near top dead center. So as I rotate the engine around, the piston's starting to get close to the top of the bore. You can see the plunger coming out here, and you'll notice the numbers on my indicator going up. And then they maxed out here somewhere around 8.3. 8.31, I think, and then you'll see they start going down as I continue to rotate the engine. So you saw them going up as the piston travels toward the top of the bore, and now they're going down as the piston travels back down the bore. And eventually it zeroes because there's not enough travel to read the entire stroke with one of these dial indicators. But what we need to do is to set the dial indicator up so instead of reading a high number at top dead center, I want it to read zero when the engine is at top dead center. And that's not terribly hard to do. So what I do is I rotate the engine over in the direction that it normally travels. And with these Minarelli engines, your engine is going to rotate this way. If you're looking at it from this side, it's rotating clockwise. So I'm going to rotate the engine over in that direction. And I see my numbers start to go up. Now I'm going to go really slow. I can actually kind of skip forward because I know I was over 8 millimeters. But I'm going to go kind of slow. Now I'm at 7.5 roughly. Getting close to 8. 8.16, 17, 18, 23, 24, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. I believe I saw 31 earlier. Maybe not. Okay, so I've got 8.30 is what I'm seeing for my top dead. Well, 8.31 now. I'm going to go back. I like to rotate the engine in the direction that it normally rotates when I do this, just to make sure there's no play. So go back and then go back up toward top dead center. I'm going to zero it right now at 8.3, which on this gauge I just have to press the zero button. On the analog gauges you'll have to rotate the outer face of the gauge so the zero lines up. I just repositioned the camera so you can see the plunger as well, and I'll show you one more time. So I'm going to rotate the engine in its regular direction of rotation, clockwise. You see it goes all the way down. I'm going to come back around. You see the number now is actually going down because my zero, my lowest number, is top dead center. So it's going to go down, continue to go down, until it reaches top dead center. And while it's going down, you'll see that the plunger is actually protruding out. That's kind of showing you exactly where the piston is, what the piston's doing. Because the higher this, the more this plunger comes out, the higher the piston is in the bore. So now I'm 0.8 something. Keep going real slow. I get to zero, which should be my top dead center. You'll see this plunger is as high as it's going to get. And then as I keep rotating, the plunger will start going down. And then you'll actually see the numbers on here. They'll be negative numbers, but they'll increase. So that's my piston going down the bore. All right, so at this point, my dial indicator should be set up so that it's showing me exactly where top dead center is. The next thing we should do is find out exactly where our ignition timing needs to be set relative to top dead center. So the obvious place to look for that information would be in the instructions with the ignition kit. Unfortunately, in my opinion, MVT has dropped the ball a little bit here. I will put close-ups on the screen, but right up here at the top of the instructions, they tell you to set the ignition timing to 0.35 millimeters before top dead center if you're engine is larger than 50cc, which I can't remember exactly how it translates right this second, but basically if your engine is larger than 50cc. They don't tell you where to set it if your engine is 50cc. I did some searching for clarification, and what I found is that MVT seems to specify 0.4 millimeters before top dead center for engines with a standard stroke. While in the instructions they go by displacement, but it seems like the proper way is to go by stroke length. So standard stroke for this engine is 39.2 millimeters. So even if you had, say, a 70cc kit on here, most of those would use a standard stroke, so you would want 0.4 millimeters before top dead center by their specifications. And then if you have a longer than stock stroke, then they say to set the ignition timing at 0.35 millimeters before top dead center. Also, I found that if you have the MVT EEPROM ignition, or EEPROM CDI setup, which is basically a CDI that has selectable ignition curves and some adjustability. Then there are different specs online, and I've seen from 1.5 to 2.9 millimeters before top dead center for setting those. So what I would suggest is whatever kit you buy, because I believe some of this will vary depending on the exact digital direct kit that you have and the exact CDI that you have, take a little bit of time, go online, and just verify the specifications that you need to use. Because if your instructions are like mine from MVT, they aren't very clear. Since this 86cc does indeed have a stroker crank, it has a 44 millimeter stroke, I'm going to use 0.35 millimeters before top dead center as my starting point for the ignition setup. There are a couple more things we need to be aware of in order to properly set up the ignition timing. The first is the rotor. You should see that there is one timing mark on this rotor. There's one line here, it's kind of red or orange, and that is used as a timing indicator in this case. You'll see there's no others on here. That needs to align with one of the two lines that are on the stator. When you look at the stator, you'll see that one line has an arrow going this way, going clockwise. One line has an arrow going this way or counterclockwise. So you need to know which direction your engine rotates in standard operation. So if I'm looking at this engine from this side, my flywheel in standard operation, the engine is rotating this way, it's rotating clockwise. So because the engine rotates clockwise, I need to choose this line with the arrow that rotates clockwise. When I install my rotor, what I want to do, once I've got the engine set at the proper timing, I want to install my rotor so that the line on the rotor aligns with this line here on the stator as close as I can get it. So just to recap before I do this, here are the major points that you need to pay attention to properly install the rotor onto the engine. The first is you need to know the manufacturer's specification for the timing, for the distance, before top dead center that they would like the marks to align. The next critical point to pay attention to is the relationship of this specification to top dead center. And all of the specifications we'll see should be before top dead center. That's important because there are actually two spots when you rotate the engine that you can match that specification that you have. I'm just going to go with 0.35 millimeters in this case, for example. So if I rotate the engine over, I'm rotating in the normal direction of travel. My piston's going to start coming up the bore. It's headed to the top, and then we'll get roughly at my specification here. I'm at 0.34, but close enough. So now the piston is on its way up to the top. I'm at my spec. I haven't reached top dead center yet, so this is before top dead center. And then I keep rotating the engine in the normal direction of travel. Piston comes all the way up to the top of the bore. Then if I continue rotating in the same direction of travel, the piston will start going down the bore. And then you'll see we get to the same specs this way. But we don't want to set the engine when the piston is on its way down the bore, because that is after top dead center. We always want to rotate the engine in the direction that it normally travels and set to our spec when the piston is on its way up the bore before top dead center. And that is very important because otherwise your timing is going to be way off. And the other things that we need to pay close attention to are the markings themselves on both the rotor and the stator. Rotor only has one marking again. We're looking at this red mark here. And then on the stator, we have to make sure that it is the mark with the arrow that indicates the proper direction of rotation for our engine. And as long as we pay attention to all of those, we should be able to get our ignition set up properly. If you're using an analog indicator, what you see may be a little bit different than me using my digital indicator. So I just wanted to show you a quick example here of maybe how that would work. And unfortunately, I don't have a metric analog indicator. This is standard, but it has very similar graduations with kind of the 0 to 100, like you'll see with a lot of the metric indicators. So I've just got it on a stand and I'm moving it with my fingers But let's just pretend I have it dialed in at zero for top dead center. So if I were coming around toward the zero and I wanted to set 35 before top dead center, then I actually would be stopping at the 65 mark, because that is 35 before top dead center. And you just have to be conscious of that. This one actually does have double graduation, so you may see beside the 60 I've got a 40, and beside the 70 I have a 30. But essentially what you can do is just subtract your number from 100. So if you want to go 35 from top dead center, subtract 35 from 100, and you'll see that's 65 instead. So you'd want to stop on the 65. And if it was 40, then you'd want to stop on the 60, etc. So just basically a warning here to be conscious of what kind of indicator that you have, and adjust accordingly to make sure you get it set up right. And you could even use a standard indicator if you'd like, but just do the conversions to metric so that you can do it properly. Before I do the installation, if you recall earlier in the video, I cleaned the crankshaft and told you that the taper where the rotor and the crankshaft interact are very important to help hold this in place. So I cleaned it. I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm just going to give it a quick cleaning. I'm not going to use the brush or anything on this. Just going to clean it off with some brake parts cleaner because I want to make sure there's no residue on there and it can get a good grip on the crankshaft. Alright, so now I'm going to rotate the engine over in the direction of travel, again clockwise for this engine, until I see 0.35 millimeters before top dead center. Obviously, again, my gauge won't tell me it's before top dead center, but when the piston's on the way up, I want it to see 0.35 millimeters before it reaches that top dead center mark. I'm going to go really slowly when I get near it. Okay, so there's my 0.35 millimeters. That's before I've reached top dead center. That's exactly where I want to install the rotor. So now I'm going to take the rotor, I'm going to slide it onto the crankshaft, doing my best to make sure that this mark here aligns with the timing mark on my stator. Again, same one with the arrow that indicates the proper direction of rotation. And while I'm doing this, I've got my hand on the other side of the engine trying to hold the engine still so that it doesn't move from that mark. I believe I'm a little off, so I'm still holding the engine with my other hand, and I'm just trying to rotate the rotor until it looks like it's aligned. Here's a better look at the marking on the rotor as well as the stator. You should be able to see that they're pretty well aligned, and also my indicator is still setting on 0.35 millimeters from top dead center. Now I'm going to put this washer in place as gently as I can. I'm trying not to move this flywheel anywhere. And then I want to be sure that this doesn't rotate relative to the crankshaft. So, little disclaimer, I am not a fan of hitting a crankshaft or anything attached to it with a hammer in general. But what I'm going to do, after I've got the washer on, I'm going to take my socket that's normally for the flywheel nut. I'm going to put it on that washer. Again, I'm going to be as careful as I can. And I'm going to give it a light tap or two to try and just push this in a little bit to hopefully get it to begin to seat on the taper of the crankshaft, because I don't want it to move. Again, I'm going to give it light taps. This is not going to be a beating. That's it. I don't want to hit it any more than that. Now I'm going to hold the variator with my hand on this side and then begin to try tightening this nut down with just a ratchet and a socket. I'm not going to try to go for full torque spec, but I just want to try and get it tightened down so it's interacting with the taper as much as it can before I go for the final torque. And it's okay if the engine rotates. Hopefully the rotor will rotate with it at this point. Okay, again, that's not final torque by any means, but I did get some pressure applied there. I'm just going to recheck that my markings align when I'm at the proper spec on my indicator. And right now I'm at 0.35 millimeters before top dead center, and the marks look right onto me. If anything moves at this point, you're going to have to redo it. But hopefully, if you follow the steps up to here, just like me, hopefully it'll be locked in and you won't have to worry about that. So now I just need to hold the engine in place so that I can apply the final torque to this nut by manufacturer's specs. Okay, so I've got a strap wrench set up to hold the variator side of the crankshaft because I need to apply final torque to this nut. And on this rotor, they're all threaded holes. There aren't two holes that are just designed for a holding tool like this, and I don't like the idea of putting this holding tool inside of the threads unless I actually had something to thread into them, which I don't, that attaches to that tool. Just in case you need it, here's a quick example of a strap wrench. Basically, you'll wrap this around this rubber piece. We'll go into this little groove here. Need to figure out which way you're going to hold it. In this case, the engine's going to try to rotate that way, and I want to resist that, so I'm trying to put pressure kind of going back this way. So I'm going to put it around like this. Kind of pull the strap tight. And then you'll see this one has little teeth. They engage with the strap here. And I'll basically just put pressure on it like that. You pretty much just hold on to it, hold pressure. It's pretty self-explanatory once you actually try it. So I'm just going to try to hold it from the other side and torque this down to spec, which I'm using Yamaha's spec for the 2008 Zuma from that manual, which is 27 foot-pounds. Okay. At this point, I should be able to rotate the engine around using the rotor and not have to worry about it because it's torqued down to spec. But before I can call this done as far as the actual installation of the rotor, I need to rotate this again so that these two marks line up and just verify that I still hit the mark that I'm supposed to, the 0.35 millimeters before top dead center on my indicator. That looks good to me. My indicator is at the timing spec that I wanted. And the two marks are still aligned on my rotor and my stator if I look at them straight on. So that part of the job is done. I'm going to remove my indicator from the engine, beginning by moving the indicator from the adapter. And then I can unthread the adapter from the engine. Now you can reinstall the spark plug or use a brand new spark plug. Now I want to deal with the wires coming through this hole in the cases, because unfortunately MVT does not include any kind of grommet to protect the wires, although they do have the covering here. You still don't want that rubbing up against any potential sharp edges on the hole in the case. The common solution seems to be to remove the grommet from your stock stator and then put that onto the wires from the MVT. I actually have one here that I cut off of an aftermarket stator that no longer works, so I happen to have a spare. Another option would be to find a more universal grommet, and an easy way might be to buy a grommet assortment like this. In here I found these are 1 inch outside diameter by 5/8 inside diameter, and that seems to be the best fit among what's in here. I stuck the grommet in there from that universal kit just to show you how it looks, even though it's not what I'm going to use. And you can see it protects the wires from running into anything on the cases, but you won't get any kind of sealing there if you were concerned with that. I'm going to use this stock style that I had on an old stator. The only problem with these, they're a little tougher than the others, because to get them on and off, you'll probably want to remove this 3-pin connector. In this case, it's only got two in there, but these large connectors from your harness. Because even with this one, I can start it through there pretty easy, but where it gets to the smaller portion to seal around the wires, I don't really want to damage my grommet in order to get it on and off. So I'll show you how to remove these connectors and reinstall them. In order to remove this connector from the end of the wires, you'll need to remove it one terminal or one wire at a time. So if you look at the end of these connectors, you should see there's kind of a large section here, then there's a little smaller section down here. I'm just showing you on the empty one because I think it's easier to see that shape there. So what you'll need is something like a very small precision screwdriver like this, a flathead. There are specialty tools for it, and you may even be able to use a small pick. But you want to take that screwdriver, small screwdriver, or whatever tool you've got, and you're going to put it into this small section and just press down there. And what that's doing is there's a little pin inside, and you're disengaging that pin and hopefully letting this slide through. So I've got my screwdriver kind of pushed into there. You don't want to put a lot of force and try to break anything. Then, while that's still in there, I'm just going to pull from the other side on that wire. You can see the wire then comes out. The terminal comes out. Repeat the process for the other wire that's left in there. Now it should be easy to remove or install the grommet without this connector on the end. So to install, I'm going to go one wire at a time through my grommet. You still want to go one at a time because you do have terminals on the end there. So it's not a good idea to try to fit them all through at once. Just feed those through. And then you can work the grommet up the wires. Then you can get it seated into the engine case. It's going to take a little bit of pressure. Just kind of work it around and down in there. Now you'll need to reinstall the wires into the connector. But before you do, if you look at each one of the terminals, you should see there's this little tab on the back side here that kind of sticks out. And that is used to help retain this terminal into the connector. Sometimes those will get bent too much when you remove them, so I like to go in there and just bend that up a little bit to be sure I'll get good contact next time, and do that on each terminal. And this one you can actually see quite a bit. Hopefully you can see that in the camera. That's bent way in, so that definitely would not seat properly if I didn't take care of that now. Once you've done that, the installation of each wire is really simple. If you look at the back of the terminal, you'll again see you've got kind of a large box and then a very small section at the bottom of it. That small section will interact with that tab that we just bent out. Make sure you've got the wire in the proper spot, and then you just slide it in with a tab facing that small section there. You should hear it snap or click, and then it doesn't pull out. Repeat the process with the other wire, again making sure it's in the proper spot in your connector. Done. From here, finishing up the engine work for the MVT installation basically just means that we need to reinstall our cooling system components. So if you have an air-cooled engine, you've got these three threaded holes here in the rotor, and that will allow you to install your cooling fan, and then you can put your shrouds back in place. For me, I'll be doing the same liquid-cooled kind of setup that I had before, using a crank-driven water pump. So I'll need to start by installing these studs for the water pump, and I'm just going to put a drop of medium-strength thread locker on each one before it goes in. Then I need to install a bushing over each one of these studs, and I just put a small amount of grease on there. Helps it slip into the water pump drive and over these studs. It should just press on. Now the water pump needs to be installed, and basically you're just going to align three of these holes with the three bushings here. And you can kind of look in from the side just to help you get those lined up as they need to be. And then it should push into place. Although this one is not really pushing in very much. I think we might have a problem here. I'm just going to put a couple bolts in to hold this so I can show you. Alright, so now we're looking in from where the stator cover would be. The white wheel you see there is the water pump drive wheel. This black disc is the rotor. And maybe you can tell, I'm not getting a whole lot of engagement between the grommets and the drive system right in there, and the white wheel there, the drive wheel. Normally on my water pump, I will actually run spacers underneath of the cases, just small spacers to make sure I've got even spacing with my water pump. And right now I have the spacers out. This is as tight as it can get in there, and I still don't have a great engagement. After a little bit of measuring, I found that the rotor is about 6 millimeters thick, and there are about 8.5 millimeters sticking out of this water pump drive stud. The best I could find around here, I have two M6 washers that will slide over there. They are about 3 millimeters thickness, so I'm probably missing out on about 0.5 millimeter of engagement potentially with the rotor, but that's probably about as close as I'm going to get with what I have around here. And I'm not sure if that's going to make enough difference, but I hope it will. Let's see how this goes now. Takes a little bit of pressure to get on there. You can see it's not just falling off. It actually takes a little bit of force to remove it, so I think that should be okay. In the event that something like that doesn't work for you and you have a spacing issue like I had, Ryan Ott also told me in the past about his Zuma, because the Yamaha cases are a little different, and I believe they stick out further, or this sits in further and causes spacing issues. What can be done is to take roller weights and bolt them to your flywheel or rotor. This is an M6 by 1.0 thread for these, so get M6 bolts, and then he was using 15 by 12 roller weights, two of them stacked up, bolted in here, and those he said interacted well with the water pump drive, and he didn't have any wear issues. So if something like that, spacing doesn't work for you, maybe that would be worth a shot. And normally I would put medium strength thread locker on these as well and snug them down with a ratchet or possibly torque to spec. In this case, I'm actually going to take my engine apart for some other stuff. At least take the water pump cover off later. So mostly I'm doing this because I wanted to show you guys kind of a full how-to for the MVT, at least the engine related parts of it. Now if you've got a stator plate or stator cover for this area, then that should go on now. And this one was homemade. I've got information on that in one of my liquid-cooled conversion videos if you're interested. Pretty simple bolt-on cover. Now I can move back to this side and reinstall my CVT cover. This should pretty much wrap up the engine work, aside from if you're going to mess with the ignition timing with a timing light later, then you may want to do some setup related to that, which I will do probably in the next video. But if you're just going to leave it with standard settings, then you're basically done with the engine for now. Then you'll see you have the coil as well as the CDI left in your MVT box. And of course you've got wiring coming out of the stator. I'm not going to do a full coverage of the wiring of this kit because the scooter that I'm installing it in is not standard. I've changed connectors around. I built the entire wiring harness from scratch myself. My charging system is currently full wave, so I've got a different regulator rectifier than I should have for it, so mine will not plug in. The wiring shouldn't be too difficult for most people with standard scooters that this was meant for, like the Yamaha, Zuma, and probably some of the Aprilias, Chinese clones, etc. But basically, you'll have this connector comes out of your stator. That should plug into existing wiring. These are the charging and lighting wires. These come out of your stator, and there are wires coming out of your CDI that will match up to those, so you just color match those. Then out of your CDI, you should have these connectors, and most likely they will connect into your stock wiring harness. Then you're left with a coil, and there's really not much wiring to that. That's basically just plug it in and go, other than it needs the coil wire installed, which I will show you just in case you're not familiar with doing that. You should be able to see if you look at the end that there is copper wire in the center there. If anything looks wrong with that, just cut a little bit off of the end of the entire wire to make sure you have a good fresh start there. And then when you look at the ignition coil, right in here is a screw basically sticking out of the ignition coil. All you have to do is take the plug wire, basically put it in here. It just barely fits with this one, and you're going to screw it onto that screw that's sticking out of the coil. And pretty much you just keep screwing that in until you can't screw it in any further. Eventually it should get tight and stop moving. And when you're doing this, put a little inward pressure there just to help it along. That's nice and snug now, and then you just slide this boot the rest of the way on over there. And once you're finished, just tug on that a little bit. Don't pull too hard because you could rip it out of there even if it's installed correctly. But just give it a gentle tug and make sure the wire's not going anywhere. And that's basically all that there is to installing the spark plug wire on this.
I'm going to briefly mention an issue that you could run into while installing an aftermarket ignition, and that is the kill switch operation. So the MVT Digital Direct, like I have, is what is called a normally open or ground to kill type of ignition. So what it does is it applies a ground in order to shut the ignition system off. There are some ignition systems that are normally closed or ground to run, and they do exactly the opposite basically. And they apply a ground when the engine is running and then take the ground away in order to shut the engine off. So my Chinese scooter is a normally open or ground to kill system, so I don't really have any trouble. It should hook right up to mine, and my ignition switch and my kill switch should work fine. But if you have some scooters, like I know the Yamaha Zumas, they use a normally closed ground to run system, so they're doing exactly the opposite of what the MVT wants to see. So when you turn your key on, if you have a Zuma, it's actually going to apply a ground, which the MVT will see as a kill signal, so it will not allow spark. And when your key is off, then it will be allowing a spark. So that's bass ackwards of what you actually want to have happen. The way that most people fix this, to my knowledge, is by installing a relay in their ground circuit or in their kill circuit. And I'll put a graphic up on the screen to give you a basic idea of this. I can't give you a exact wiring diagram because it could vary from scooter to scooter, but this is roughly how it happens. Using a normally closed relay or the normally closed side of one relay to kind of convert this over. Even if you fix the ignition switch with a relay, you could still run into an issue with your kill switch. Now, it may just be that your kill switch operation is backwards. So when the engine is in run, it's actually killing the ignition signal, and when it's in kill, then it's actually allowing the engine to run, which that in itself wouldn't be a big deal. But there can be a problem with some scooters that use a more advanced kill switch that also affects starter operation. This is my T-Max because unfortunately my other scooters don't have this kind of operation of their kill switch. So just for example, if I set this in run, then it will allow my starter to work. But then if I try the same thing, when it's in kill, it doesn't let my starter work. So if you were using electric start, that could cause a problem because you're going to have your kill switch in the kill position in order to start the engine, to allow the engine to run without other kinds of fixes. If you don't use an electric starter, then that won't be any big deal. It won't affect you. Your kill switch will basically just work backwards and you'll have to turn it to kill to run and run to kill. But again, if your electric start system is still working, that could be an issue for you. Aftermarket parts can help you solve this situation easily. This is a setup sold by Motion Pro, seems to be made by Domino, but it's a kill switch or stop start switch, as well as a starter button. So if you wire this up, as long as you pick the proper one, because some of these are available in normally closed or normally open, so pick the proper one for your needs, and then you can wire everything up this way, and it should work just fine. You don't have to have that backwards kill switch or be missing electric start functionality. Hopefully I've been able to cover most of the questions you would have about installing a racing ignition system like this MVT Digital Direct. I know I can't cover everything exactly like the wiring because my scooter again is a little bit different than standard. I will try to mention some of that in my next video. It will not be a strict how-to, but I'll at least give you some coverage, some information about how that goes together. I also plan to get out the timing light and to find out where the ignition timing actually is, because 0.35 millimeters before top dead center doesn't mean a whole lot to me, and I'm sure it doesn't mean a lot to a lot of you guys as well. So I'd like to just see what shows up on a timing light if possible. I'll cover that in the next video. I'm also hoping to do some sort of back-to-back kind of comparison. I took a little bit of video just real quick of the scooter before I installed the MVT, and then I'm going to try and do the same kind of clips after the MVT just to get an idea of what it's actually doing for me if possible. And again, that will probably all be in the next video, if not the next couple of videos. So please stay tuned, make sure you subscribe and ring the bell to get notifications. Please like the video if you enjoyed it or found it helpful, and thank you for watching.